Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Good morning. Larry Young sitting in for Brother Carlton Douglas, and the team is on board, and Carlton should be giving us a morning quick call in. In the meantime, I've got a fine attorney with a diverse responsibilities, and she's going to tell you about what she does and how come. Good morning, good lady.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us today, Senator Young. I am Tehma Smith Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell a property, to purchase your ground rent, or to create or update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. Once again, that's 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation and you're not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or your comment to the same number, 667-334-7242. And as always, if you miss a broadcast, please feel free to check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is go to YouTube and type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up. So you can listen to them on your phone, your computer, your television, and you can share them with others. So as always, thank you for joining us today. We look forward to the conversation.
Thank you. And we did get word that the Brother Esquire Robert Dashiell is going to be about business, that he cannot join us this morning. We certainly are going to miss him. And as I stated, I was expecting a call in from Brother Carlton Douglas. I'm sure we'll get it. But as they say, the show must go on. And so with that being the case, I do want to let you know that Larry Young, I come on board here on WLB 1010 on Mondays from 10 until 11. And we certainly will be, God willing, here in place this coming Monday morning. And you will want to be a part of that show. It's going to be hot. And but right now, we are on the board to launch a hot show right here. And we're going to have a special guest. And why don't I get started with the world of business?
Yes, August is Black Business Month. And Black Business Month recognizes the importance of African-American businesses and entrepreneurs for their contribution to the nation's economy. Today we have joining us in our News You Can Use or Information for Dissemination segment, Mr. Christopher Lundy, Esquire. He is the director of the Baltimore City Mayor's Office of Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development. Mr. Chris Lundy was raised in West Baltimore in the Windsor Hills neighborhood with his mother, who was a single mother, who returned to night school to obtain her law degree. Mr. Lundy attended Mount St. Joe High School and developed his passion for advocacy as president of the speech and debate team. He then went on to study political science at Temple University, and he received a law degree from Widener University. Mr. Lundy is inspired by his mother's career with the Office of the Maryland Attorneys General and has been fortunate to be able to dedicate his career to public service. As director of the Mayor's Office of Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development, he has brought his zeal, advocacy, and approach as a litigator to this role to expand the availability and capacity of the minority and women business community. He has established enforcements of the MWB program requirements, and he has successfully levied historical sanctions against a prime contractor for failing to promptly pay their MBE subcontractors. And he has recently completed the first city disparity study since 2014, analyzing the city's utilization of MWBE programs. Mr. Lundy, are you with us? Good morning, Mr. Lundy.
Hello?
Is the phone on?
Yes.
Over there?
Yes. Yes. Everything that we need over here is ready, partner.
It says it's on air over here.
Yeah. Family, hold tight. We're going to work this out. I'm sure we can get it corrected in just a moment.
Good morning, Mr. Lundy. How are you doing today?
Hey, good morning. Thank you all so much for having me. How are you?
Thank you for your patience.
Sorry for the technical difficulty. We just went over your wonderful bio so the listeners have an idea of who you are. Can you give us information about your function in the Mayor's Office of Small and Business Minority Development and Advocacy?
Sure thing. Yeah, our new name is a bit of a handful, but it's the Mayor's Office of Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development, and I'm fortunate to be our inaugural director of that mayoral office. And first and foremost, my position is to advocate and develop small and minority businesses. This is a new agency that we've put together that recognizes the need for greater support and resources, particularly in the small and minority business community. And this is a combination of the former MBU office, the Minority and Women's Business Opportunity Office, and the Mayor's Office of Minority and Women's Business Development. So we've come together to bring all those services together. So now we do certification, contract compliance, investigations, outreach, development. We also oversee the Baltimore Main Streets Program and also the U.S. Department of Commerce's Minority Business Development Agency's Advanced Manufacturing Center in Baltimore.
Thank you. And what services or resources do you offer to business owners or individuals interested in starting businesses?
You were at the right place. We provide a host of resources. Currently, we have, I believe it's 95 webinars annually. And these include great topics like creating a winning business plan, banking and budgeting basics, business finance, cash flow planning, and budgeting during a crisis. And these are webinars that we do virtually, and we're going to start doing them in a hybrid format throughout the year. We also have additional programming at the Small Business Resource Center. And if you don't make it out to there, we luckily have an online platform for small businesses. It's www.baltimoresourcelink.com. And at that location, you can find business guides to start common businesses such as restaurants, childcare, barbershops and salons, automotive repair, retail and grocery, and also green businesses. It'll also give you that background on what you need from a licensing and permitting standpoint. And really has dedicated resources for both startup growth, funding, and grants, giving you those steps for successful startups. And you can access that from that website directly or via the main website for my agency, which is the smba-b.baltimorecity.gov, or you can simply go to the mayor's office at baltimorecity.gov and get to these great resources.
On that website, you list a number of different businesses that you can go on there and get information on how to start. What seems to be the trend of businesses that are opening up in Baltimore City or that are taking advantage of your resources?
Right now, we're definitely seeing a growth in retail businesses. Okay. We've seen a lot of programs. One of our partners in this work, Downtown Partnership, has the Boost program that's been putting minority businesses into vacant storefronts. We're doing the same thing in our Baltimore Main Streets, trying to promote businesses in those areas so we don't have as many vacants. So retail is definitely something that's growing. We're seeing a host of different types of businesses that people can do and are moving towards that retail storefront to be able to have that that frontward-facing position in the community.
And I know this agency was opened up to kind of encourage more women and more minorities to go in business, especially with local business government contracting. What type of contracting opportunities are there available in Baltimore City?
So in the city, we contract for all of the services that we provide. So this is a great opportunity for anybody that's looking to either bolster their existing business portfolio or trying to establish a book of business that would be able to be a bedrock for them. So we do work in every sector. So construction, architecture and engineering, goods and other services, and also those professional services. As of the last disparity study that was completed in 2022, the MGT disparity study, our largest spend category was construction, and that was at a little over $2.2 billion, and it was followed by goods and services. With that being said, the city is spending throughout all of these categories, and we recognize that there's significant room to improve and spend more with MWBEs, especially when we look at categories like architecture and engineering and also professional services.
Okay, and what seems to be the demographics of the people taking advantage of these opportunities? I know it's for minorities and it's for women, but what is typically the age range or what minorities are seeking these opportunities the most?
I would definitely say our Black African-American business owners are extremely eager to gain knowledge and resources, and they are taking advantage of the resources that we have on offer. I would say we're seeing a lot more young people take the leap into entrepreneurship and use that as a way to change their trajectory in life in the city. So we're seeing a lot of young people that get into a host of businesses. We're seeing some people get into the new emerging technologies with solar, whether that be a solar energy with homes. We're seeing also electric vehicle chargers and things like that. One of the things we're doing to celebrate Black Business Month is we actually have a speaker series ongoing at the Small Business Resource Center, and we began this last Tuesday with how to take advantage of city procurement for business growth. We're going to be continuing this month with our next one on August 15th about what you should look for in accounting for business growth. On August 22nd, we'll have some financing options, and on the 29th, we'll be rounding out with bond and surety and how you obtain those things for business growth. And we are looking in the near future to also have a legal series that'll focus on contracting, succession planning, and often overlooked issues that can severely cost or even jeopardize a business.
That is wonderful. I know you mentioned one of the services that you offer is assistance with certifications. What type of certifications are needed to do business with Baltimore City? Are they needed or are they not needed to do business with Baltimore City? And what's the advantage of having these certifications?
Sure. So everyone is eligible to do business with the city. You just need to be in good standing with the state of Maryland, with FDAT. And be duly organized. So you can always do business with the city. We encourage everyone to do business. What we do have is a minority and women's business program that does certify businesses as MBE, Minority Business Enterprise, Women's Business Enterprise, or Minority Women's Business Enterprise. And in doing so, that enables those businesses to partner with the city and work on city contracts. We set subcontractor participation goals that are able to be satisfied by those certified businesses. And these goals are set on all on an individual basis on all contracts that exceed $50,000. And this also includes private developments that receive city funding. So even if it's not actually a city agency, if it's a large project like our wonderful project at Baltimore Peninsula that was a pilot, a payment in lieu of taxes that got some of that financing, they had goals on that project. So even when it's private things, it makes you more competitive. And you're able to be visible in our active certification directory so that obviously went for any city contracts, but even when the private sector, local universities or other jurisdictions are seeking out NWBEs, they're able to see you there. And importantly, our city certification is not limited to Baltimore City. Our marketplace is really more so regional. So our if you have an operating office that's active in Baltimore City, Baltimore County, Howard, Carroll, Anne Arundel, Queen Anne's, and Harford counties, that's an active operating office, you are eligible for certification. Additionally, some of those jurisdictions also reciprocally rely upon that city certification and accept it for their contracts. And those would be specifically Baltimore County, Anne Arundel, Howard, and Montgomery counties. They will accept city certification for an MBE or WBE when you're working on their projects.
That's wonderful. And I know a lot of people might be hesitant about participating in city contracting because they really don't know what to expect. What should their expectations be when they decide to do procurement through Baltimore City? What can they reasonably expect the process to be like?
Sure. So first and foremost, you want to make sure that you're registered with our online marketplace to do a business with the city. And that's Workday. We made a transition last August away from CityBuy. Workday is now the new procurement platform. So for information on doing business with the city, if you go to procurement.baltimorecity.gov/doing-business-city, it'll give you some information on resources on how you can register and some additional things for doing work in Workday. But that's where you're going to see any of the bid opportunities, ongoing contracts is in that Workday platform. If you're dealing with informal procurements or small spends under $50,000, things over $25,000 have to go to the Board of Estimates. So that adds some complexity to it. But if you're dealing with those formal bids over $50,000, expect to see that solicitation advertised. It'll, of course, be listed on Workday, but it'll be advertised in our local newspapers and also online there. Once that bid has been on the street for the requisite time, we'll receive the bids, open them, review them, and the end user agency, in collaboration with the Bureau of Procurement, will select the responsive and responsible bidders to recommend for an award. And then that ultimately gets approved by our spending board, the Baltimore City Board of Estimates, that's made up of course, our wonderful mayor, Brandon Scott, our city comptroller, Bill Henry, Council President Mosby, our solicitor, Ebony Thompson, and now our interim DPW head, Richard Luna. They all preside over all of those matters and will make the public discussion and determination whether the ultimate spending and award should be made. And then once you're on the contract, all of the payments and invoicing will happen in collaboration with the agency and via that Workday portal.
And I know you have experience in this as being an advocate, but a lot of small businesses might be worried about receiving payment from the city in a timely manner. What should they expect from that in terms of, is that something that generally doesn't happen, or is that something that they will probably have to plan for because it happens more frequently than not? What happens, what should that mindset be when thinking about a payment from the city?
Yeah, that is an excellent point to raise. As always, you want to make sure that you're prepared for what you're walking into with these contracts. I would say, first and foremost, when you initially get on a city contract, there may be some delay with that initial payment and the initial invoicing. So you have to be prepared that that may not happen as quickly as you're used to, potentially, in the private sector. This is an issue that I'm extremely passionate about. I understand the impact that it has on businesses and how much we've been dealing with of this problem for an extended period of time. One of the things, like I alluded to with Workday, that we've done to really try to expedite that process is to be able to have the approval pass within that system. With that being said, the payment timetable is not at all where I would like it to be. Luckily, I have some excellent partners in the agency heads, and specifically our new city purchaser, Adam Manny, that oversees the Bureau of Procurement. And I'm really confident that we're going to be continuing to take some positive steps to ensuring that everyone is paid promptly. One thing under the comptroller's leadership, he's been pivotal in getting accounts payable to satisfy invoices once they're actually received by AP within 24 hours. So that is a very, very positive change that we can say. What we're working on now is the internal agency approval passed before it gets to accounts payable to ensure that people are paid within 30 days. And it definitely is a work in progress, but we are keenly aware of the need to move that forward. And I want to highlight for our MWBE subcontractors, they are to be paid within 7 days of the prime being paid by the city. We've added in additional contract compliance officers, and we'll also be adding additional investigators to ensure that that is taking place. It's imperative that businesses contact my agency and advise the end user agency that's overseeing the contract via their project manager to ensure they're aware of any payment delays or issues on the project involving the prime contractor. One of the problems we've had historically is that we learn of these things sometimes months and unfortunately even a year or more after they've occurred. And it makes it difficult to ensure that that work still exists for that business to do and to get them paid timely once they've already been through the struggle of the delay. So we're really trying to make sure that we're responsive when we're hearing about these issues and investigating them in partnership with the agencies to make sure people are getting paid.
If someone has a business idea, what would be your pitch to tell them, come see my office right away? Don't take shortcuts to try to create your business and start your business with all the information. What would be your words of encouragement for them to come and check out the resources that you have as they begin?
Well, I would say we've really been able to help a lot of local businesses and a lot of local businesses over the course of time. You know, obviously our agency itself is new, but the work that we've been doing is not. And, you know, my great colleague, Paul Taylor, this director of the Small Business Resource Center, has worked with many businesses throughout the community to establish and to be successful. And many of them are pillars within our business community now that have been able to grow and benefit from those things. I would also say that really, We do have the resources to help someone when they just have that idea. To go from that idea to really map that concept out with developing a business plan or a business canvas to really flesh out what is required for them to get from that idea. Also to point out some other additional resources that are needed to start the business, whether that be zoning and permits, but also seeking out that legal guidance to make sure that you're picking the most appropriate business organization for yourself, whether that be to be a sole proprietor, creating a partnership, LLC, or a corporation, but so that we can provide that guidance so you don't have a misstep that impacts the way you think the business should be operated.
And in closing, I know we're trying to support and increase Black-owned businesses and entrepreneurs, and I know that your organization probably has a list of the Black entrepreneurs and Black businesses in Baltimore City, but is there a list that's made available to the public in case people, individuals in Baltimore City wants to hire a good business owner who does construction or who does plumbing or who might have a apparel store that they might want to support? Is there a listing available for the residents?
Yes, there is. It's at baltimorecity.diversitycompliance.com. And you can reach that off of our website, or you can go there directly. And this is where we have our active certification directory of minority women-owned businesses, minority women-owned businesses. And the beautiful thing at, when you get to the directory is you can search by particularized business NAICS codes for the type of work that they do. You can put in an address and search within a certain geographic parameter for businesses. And, of course, you can limit it just to minority businesses that are based in Baltimore. If you want to support just your local businesses and not be in the entirety of the market area, it lets you manipulate the directory to do that. Because we really are trying to highlight and amplify these businesses. And we're excited to bring even more resources. We have a few more things coming in the future that are really going to highlight our local businesses and make sure that we're doing everything we can to increase that local spend with minority women-owned businesses, and also make sure that people know that this is a repository of information where they can seek out businesses for their work and projects.
Thank you, Ken. Can you give that website one more time?
Yes. It's baltimorecity.diversitycompliance.com. And again, you can get that off of our main website at smba-d.baltimorecity.gov. And if you have any issues with any of those websites, you can just go to baltimorecity.gov and just go to the mayor's office, and you will find the link for our office on the left-hand side. And it'll take you right there to our home landing page, and it'll have all of those resources for you.
Mr. Lundy, I'd like to ask a question of you, good man. First of all, it was quite refreshing to listen to you this morning as you were responding to the questions. I can sense that you have a love for what you do.
Yes, sir. Very much so. I've been very, very fortunate to end up in this position and in this role to really be able to serve my community. Growing up in Baltimore and wanting to make an impact on my community and my city has always been something that I've been passionate about. I've dedicated my career to public service, and I really enjoy being able to meet business owners, meet young people, meet people of all ages that are finding opportunities for not just themselves, but their family and the community via business, because this is a great driver of change. Our economic development is critical for the city to continue to grow, and it's imperative that our young people see the opportunities and the successes of our business owners so that they can understand that's something that's possible for them. It's inspiring when we have people like Jason Williams from Mason-Dixon Companies, his work he did on Lexington Market. When we have people like David Bramble with the work he's going to be doing at the Harbor with the redesign, we're seeing that not only are we doing more work in the city, we're seeing that minority business owners are integral to the work that's being done.
Let me, if I can, give you a situation that is presently in front of me, and I was part of a discussion about a business opportunity. But before I do that, can you explain what the relationship between what you do in your office and that of what is being done by Stanley Tucker and Tim Smoot in the administration on the state side of the Small Business Administration Financing Authority?
Sure. Yeah, so we're completely separate from the state side. Tim is great. He's been on our certification appeals board when we were formerly MBU. So I've worked with him on the board for 7 years, and they do fantastic work. They continue to be dedicated to advancing opportunities for minority women-owned businesses, and financing is, of course, key. So I'm very thankful for the work that they do, but it is separate and apart from what we do at the local city level.
Is that because they have money to offer to businesses through the financing authority?
Yes, that's correct.
Now, at what point...
I just wanted to continue and say we are looking at additional financing vehicles in ways that we can assist people even further with access to capital. We have great relationships with a host of banks, whether it be Truist, Chase, Wells Fargo, First National, but M&T. But we're also looking for some ways that we can find some in a Baltimore community lending. we're also looking for some ways that we can find some new vehicles to get people near the capital that they need to move forward.
When they have a situation, they being Smoot and Stanley Tucker operation, do they let you know that they're getting inquiries from folk in the city for which they really should share that information with you, or do they go through the process? And do you find when you need something that you can take a client that comes in front of you and refer him or her to the state?
Oh yeah, like we definitely don't see it as a as something where there's only one avenue. We try to work in concert with anyone that is out trying to provide resources and better the community via entrepreneurship and business development. So anytime we get a reference that we're unable to specifically assist, or there's only so far we can go from our governmental role, we're looking to our partners, whether they be the financial institutions, whether they be other aspects of development that happens at the state level. We're always trying to work in concert to make this really a network and not the only thing that's going, because that's imperative for businesses, that they're not just working in Baltimore City and they're not just focused on just those contracts. We're really encouraging people to diversify their work to create that business resiliency, because we've seen throughout the pandemic, it's had a negative impact on our businesses, and one of the ways that it's done so was not necessarily always having diverse income streams of working on contracts at various levels, whether that be the local, state, and federal level, whether that be governmental work and private sector work. But we're always trying to ensure people are really diversifying and getting to the assistance they need.
I said that there was an example. There is a business that's located on Pratt Street, right across from the Hilton Hotel there, and the person is an Iranian, but he's got 30 years experience. He's good at what he does, and he now has a African American who he would like to have go into a business of a restaurant on Pratt Street downtown, right in downtown. And they went to a discussion with a bank, and it seemed as if the person was not accepting the fact that the gentleman I'm speaking with, or the African-American, were going to be able to deliver, and basically sent them back to have a discussion with someone else. When you find a bank, or, I mean, I know they got the right to handle business, but it was so clear to them that had they come in there with a Caucasian, the gentleman would have been more receptive. And if you find that kind of situation going on, who can they go and talk with?
Yeah, that's always an unfortunate story to hear, and I'd say it's still too common. You know, one thing we try to do, you know, from Baltimore Community Lending, Truist, Chase, Wells Fargo, First National, that I named, those are all people we have relationships with that we know specifically have at least one program where they're targeting minority and women-owned businesses to ensure that they get that access to capital and that they get loans. It's really important that when we work with those banks, that it's not just we have some products that we can offer you and you can jump in line with everyone else. It's that they have intentionality of working with this business community, and that they understand some of the challenges and struggles that we have when we walk into the bank for the first time. Mm. One of the things we've been trying to do that we did last summer is we did a webinar about becoming bankable, because really that's the fundamental concept here, is that you have to make sure that, like we said, with the good standing, that you're properly either incorporated, that you have your partnership, your LLC, and organized properly, that your legal documentation reflects the way you run your business in terms of the decision-making. So if you are the majority minority owner, that all of your documentation reflects that you can effectuate the day-to-day decision-making. But getting bankable, and then once you're at that point, so many things can fall into place, whether that be insurance, if you're in a field like construction that requires a surety bond. It's really about getting those fundamentals in place so that when you walk into the bank, you know what to expect. And so oftentimes, you know, finance is a field that it's almost the place kind of the principal's office that you're trying to avoid sometimes because you don't want to go in and hear what they're going to say to you because you literally wake up and go, I know what they're going to say when I get to the bank today. We're trying to give people the details of why they're going to say what they're going to say. So not only do you just have a negative outlook on what they're going to say, you know what you need to do for them to say something in your favor. And you know what you need to do with your personal credit, with your business credit, with your cash on hand, with your declarations for your taxes. A lot of people like to, minimize their tax liability, and thus it doesn't look like the business is as profitable as it even is. And all of these things, if you have that understanding that, hey, you're taking home more, but it doesn't look as well on paper, it's not going to be as positive from a banking standpoint, you can change those behaviors. So that's the stuff we're trying to do now is to set people up so that they can be on their 6-month, 1 year, hopefully at the most 2 years, depending on your circumstance, where you can rebuild yourself financially so your business is bankable and you are able to be competitive. And also the other thing to keep in mind is sometimes you have to look out for those grant opportunities. Even when you're in a position where you're not as bankable, there may be a pool of money that you can get access to. And more we're seeing large national corporations that are doing a host of different types of grants that are available. And one of them that we had recently in the area that's been going on is, of course, the Comcast Rise grant that was able to help some small businesses.
And lastly, two other questions. One is, before that, you've given me a word that I'm going to be, if you hear it often, work bankable. Now, that's the code. That's the code. When you're dealing, make sure your operation is bankable. And so I appreciate that term. And that's okay. What I noticed on Howard Street, I think Shalonda Stokes, it seems to me that there's more and more minority businesses coming along the Howard Street corridor there, right between, Center and Saratoga. Am I reading that that's a growing area where minority businesses are going to be?
Yes, very much so. So the downtown area is the fastest growing neighborhood in Baltimore, in our over 200 neighborhoods. So that says a lot. And what we're doing is that intentionality where we have our wonderful CFG Bank arena that was renovated for $200 million with CFG and Oakview Group. And they did a phenomenal job of giving us a world-class arena like we've really never seen in Baltimore. We were so overdue for that. So with that renovation, we're able to now get all of the Live Nation tours. As you've seen already, we're getting all of the big name acts that are coming to the arena. With that, we're getting a ton of new tourists and people that have not been in the area for quite some time. And we did not want to make it that our local minority and women-owned businesses would not take advantage of that. So, yes, there's been complete intentionality with Shalonda and Downtown Partnership with their boost program of ensuring that the businesses and the vacants that they're filling in that area surrounding that corridor are primarily minority and women-owned businesses.
Park Avenue, I should have added Park Avenue to that discussion. Not on Howard Street, I'm noticing, but on Park Avenue as well, I understand they got decisions to be made, but it looks like we're going to, Baltimore is going to be just fine. Just hold tight. Would you not agree, Mr. Lundy?
Oh, 100%, 100%. We are on our way. This is one of the most exciting times we've had. I know some people sometimes want to look at the past and where we've been and say that's all we can go to.
Yeah.
But that's not the nature of optimism and hope, and that's not the nature of setting a plan to do things differently. We know what has been effective and ineffective in the past. We're now trying to make a plan based on what we've seen thus far to get us to a different outcome and a different result. And it really starts with our leadership, with Mayor Scott having the foresight and intentionality to establish this agency with the other leaders he's put in place throughout the city that are really focused on this. And then, of course, I'd be remiss in not saying the leadership we're getting in Annapolis with Governor Moore and his administration. They really are focused on Baltimore. And I have to quote our governor's great line where we can't have a great Maryland if we don't have a successful and vibrant Baltimore.
No doubt.
We are pivotal to the success of the state.
Lastly, for me, the percentage of minority, the MBE cap for the city of Baltimore, is there a certain amount that is your goal that you're going to have so many have to make a certain quota in getting contracts?
So our overall aspirational goals are currently 27% for MBE and 10% for WBE.
Mm-hmm.
We do not universally apply those. So one of the things to keep our program
I just want to know, why not?
So to keep the program on sound legal footing, that is one of the things that has struck down programs in the past, where you just blanketly say, no, regardless of the availability of businesses, you have to give 27% to minority businesses on this contract. So the reason why we do that particularized analysis is to look at the actual availability and utilization in the past to get the most accurate picture of what the goal should be. So that's why you see goals of 15-5, 10-2, 27-10 as well, but you do see varying goals, and a lot of that is just based on the availability of certified businesses at that time. One of the great things we're going to be doing with the new software with B2G is we're going to be able to do that electronic goal setting directly based upon the disparity study, the most recent disparity study. So it'll be updated numbers. It'll really reflect where we are currently. And the other piece that's going to be great with that is citywide contract compliance, where we're going to be putting in all of the contracts for the city and be able to do our monitoring of the MWBE goals via the system. And it will be a requirement for both the prime contractor and the subcontractor to go in and certify the payments that are made to them. So we'll have a lot better understanding of the progress on projects as they're ongoing and just be able to see that at a glance. So there won't really be those circumstances where we're surprised at a lack of participation. We'll be able to take action as the contract is ongoing and make those changes in real time, not just lament them after the fact.
Two of the mayors that I have the most respect for, Marion Barry, and particularly the mayor of Atlanta, Maynard Jackson. And quickly, why I say that is they were trying to build the airport that's presently down in Atlanta, Georgia. You probably have heard this many times, I'm sure, as you do business. And they were trying to get the airport together. And Atlanta had decided that, of course, we're going to make sure minorities are going to get their fair share of what it's going to take to get that airport built. And the guys who got the general contract and everything, they decided they were going to say they were going to involve the minority community. But as it was being built and going along, it was very clear they were not delivering on what they said they were going to do. And so Andrew Jackson had a meeting and asked them, are you going to get to the point where you're going to involve minorities in building of this airport? And they said, yes. 3 months later, he pulled them back again. And he asked, show me what you have been able to do. And he said, now, tell me, what things will you need from the city? And they told him. And so he said, oh, okay, thank you much. But when I call back, when I have you back here in 30 days, make sure you know exactly what it is the city can do. And they tell me the guys left the meeting, and they said, what's going on? And then somebody said, we're going to need water at the airport. And the water was controlled by the mayor and the city of Atlanta. All of a sudden, they were able to make their quota. And they came back with a game plan, and that airport was built. And yes, they were able to do what they said they were going to do because they understood the power of the mayor's pen and the city. And I understand that Mayor Washington, in Washington, Marion Barry did the same thing. I gather you're trying to tell me that kind of stroke would not be considered legal these days?
Well, I think in that type of situation, I think that's the appropriate approach. And I think what you're speaking to when they're making those interjections is really the project management. We don't want to do that, honestly, at the mayoral level, having Mayor Scott have to intervene on a particular project to get them to do the work and abide by the goals. That's definitely not our approach. But I do think at the ground level for any project that we're doing, whether it's implementation of a software, whether it's a consultant redesigning the website or construction of an arena, we need our project managers and our daily inspectors to diligently document what is taking place on the project and communicate the concerns. And we need the managerial oversight as we continue to go up the chain for that, whether it be a bureau head, a deputy director of an agency, whatever would have you, to be accountable to that project manager. It's something that I know we're very much emphasizing, because that's kind of where some things are getting lost in translation, where there's things that are happening on the project that aren't always being articulated soon enough and with enough detail for us to understand the level of concern. That's one of the reasons why we're really working with my agency to make sure that we get additional investigators out there, so we can ensure that we have someone there with that keen eye on participation by those minority and women-owned businesses, and ensuring that if somebody signed a statement of intent that they were to be utilized at the beginning of the project for, say, site clearing, that they're doing it. If somebody's at the end of the project, or the middle, they're to be doing bricklaying. If it's been several months or a period of time where you haven't seen them, then we can raise that without it falling out of the project. Because the problem we get to is when those things aren't addressed, the work sometimes is lost. And what I mean by that is that the prime could do the work with their own forces, or they find another subcontractor to do it. And then if you've waited, say, 5 months, the work may be done that was already obligated to you. And we can surely take disciplinary action against that business. But my goal is to make sure whenever anybody signs a statement of intent with a prime contractor, the work as a subcontractor, that they are getting all of the work that was indicated per that percentage and dollar amount and services for that contract.
Very well.
Thank you, Mr. Lundy, for joining us today. You did provide us with a wealth of information. In closing, can you please give us your contact information and website where we can reach out to you in the future?
Oh, sure thing. Thank you all so much for having me. It's been a pleasure. Our website, again, is smba-d.baltimorecity.gov, and that's for Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development. And again, if you just go to baltimorecity.gov from the mayor's office, you can look for the mayor's office of Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development on the left-hand side. When you get to our website, you can always submit any questions as a member of the public or business owner. We have a contact button there. If you hit that, it'll go right to the appropriate member of my team to be able to address your concerns. And you can also contact me directly if needed at christopher.lundy@baltimorecity.gov.
Thank you once again, Mr. Lundy. Good luck in your new position. Seems like you have a great grasp on it and it's going very well.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the support, and I really appreciate you having me on your platform. And thank you so much for the great work that you do in serving the community and making sure great information like this gets out.
Wonderful. We look forward to talking with you again soon.
Wow. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Thank you very much.
You as well.
I got to tell you, that's one of the brighter signs of what's going on down in City Hall.
Yes, it is.
He's quite a man. I was quite impressed with how quickly he was able to respond. And I was particularly interested when you had the question put to him about, let me get it right. You were asking him a question that I've heard many, many times. And usually the guys, well, in one case, a lady in that position is hesitant, but he was quite responsive to it, and it dealt with responding to a concern.
Payments.
That's right. There you go.
Yes.
The payment issue. That's the, oh my goodness. And since I'm telling you, that was a running problem. I remember Delegate Hattie Harrison, bless her heart. She was down in Annapolis, and that was her one of the running issues. And on the Senate side, it was mentioning Tommy Broadwater, who most recent passed on. And so, and I, when you brought it up, I was waiting for the hesitation, but he admitted
right. That
that's a problem. And here we are. Now, I'm talking about the 70s and 80s and 90s, and you telling me you've sensed and heard from folks that's a running problem here in 2023.
That is a current running problem. And it's not just with the for-profit organizations that do business with the city. It's also with the non-profit organizations.
More so, I bet you.
With the city as well. And I'm not exactly sure what the issue is in terms of holding up the money. However, that is something that businesses do need to take into consideration, you know, when you're doing business. Yes, you have the contract. Yes, you're going to start the work, but you might need a little something on the side in case you don't get the payment or in case there's a payment delay. So that's definitely something you want to take into consideration with your planning and with doing business with the city.
Wow. Well, he's ready. And I'll be interested in seeing what happens. I got two people. I'm going to refer to them as soon as I come off the air. That I'm mentioning the situation. Young good man wants to put a restaurant on Pratt Street in downtown Baltimore and running into a little flack. And then another business. I'm not so sure people will be excited about it, but he wants to put up a dispensary for the marijuana.
Right. And it's good that you also brought up the bankable businesses, because a lot of businesses, if you do go into a bank on your own, you may not get the support or the finances you need from the bank. But if you can work with the organization, such as the one that Mr. Lundy runs in Baltimore City, who can kind of connect you directly and not give you an actual backing, but like a word saying that, hey, we work with this organization or this corporation and, you know, they have their things in order and, you know, we see that they will succeed. Putting forth a little word can help you get the finance and get the opportunities that you need that you may not otherwise be able to obtain on your own.
I've had a pretty decent relationship with Stanley Tucker and Tim Smoot at the Minority Business Finance Administration Authority. And I have not had too much with the local situation, so I was being educated as you were talking and discussing the issue with him. So I'm going to add him to the list. Even out of office for 25 years, people still think you know what's going on. So
right.
I'm going to continue to listen to what people focus yourself as you delve into asking the right questions. And I was very impressed with him.
Yes, he answered the questions fully, and he was very knowledgeable about the information that he presented. So if anyone in Baltimore City is looking to establish a business or has some ideas, as he said, they have a lot of resources, whether it's a webinar just to go and get information or, you know, just to have the list of other businesses that, you know, you can be put in contact with as a subcontractor or perhaps a prime if you get to that point, or just to know what other businesses in Baltimore City offer you services as an individual that you might be looking for. If you're looking for a caterer, if you're looking for a party planner, if you're looking to just support general businesses, it's good to have a website that you can go to, one that's, I guess, been vetted to one degree or another, if they have a relationship with the city that you can trust to invest not only your time but your money with.
I thought I did hear him even mention him being very inclusive of the fact that women.
Yes.
As well.
Right. So guys, it's not just minority, but they also have a push for getting more women into business in Baltimore City.
Wow. Okay. Wow. Okay. So we'll have to see.
Yes.
And if there was a... If you have a call that you'd like to share a thought with us, we certainly welcome you to come on board. Easy to do, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. And you can
text me at 667-334-7242. Once again, that's 667-334-7242. And even though we're getting ready to go on a break for the 10 o'clock hour, the 11 o'clock hour, we will have open phone conversation based on topics that we've would like to cover from the week.
And I got a hot one. I'm glad you pointed to the fact that, hold on to it, Elwin. That's all. Well, I'll tell you what I'd like to do is to let folks know that this coming Tuesday, we're going to have not a regular National Action Network Maryland chapter, Maryland Branch Baltimore chapter is going to be having not our regular meeting, which is going to be on the 15th, but rather we're going to be having an opportunity for you to come by and pay for reservations for what? A bus. What bus, LY? I'm asking those of you who are interested in going to the March on Washington, which is going to be Saturday, August the 26th, make your bus reservations, and you can do that by calling this number. But on Tuesday, We're going to be at the New Shallow Baptist Church from 6 to 7:30 only. And you can come by and make your reservation and pay for your bus trip. Now, listen, family, we have got to make this the thing to do. This bus trip going to Washington on Saturday the 26th is so important. It's the 60th anniversary of Dr. Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream speech. And you and I both know there's reason for us to gather with the thousands who are coming from all over America, coming to Washington to make a statement. We're not going back. We're not going to let Mr. Trump and his crowd play the games that they were going to play. And then we've got to make sure this man goes no further than the nomination, no further. If you look at what he's doing, just speaking up on the way he's been acting and carrying himself. Notice who he particularly puts hardcore things he's saying. Of all the people he wants to come after, notice which ones he has the worst language to say. Now, of course, let's look at this. You got a situation in New York. Black man who's the district attorney. Strong one, qualified. We'll attack him. All right? Then look at another situation. In Washington, D.C., the federal judge that he's got to deal with. She's going to be what? Powerful. She's powerful. She's qualified. She's an exceptional person in the realm of her responsibilities. I would like to get a sense of what happened today at 10 o'clock because she's not playing. She's serious about business. But this man and his administration did not do for us. And I hate to tell you this, sis, but I said this the other day. I found out that in 2020, 13% of black men voted for Donald Trump, and they're predicting that this year 15% of black men are going to vote for Donald Trump. How could that be? So we're going to gather on August 26th in Washington. We're going to have buses leaving from the New Shallow Baptist Church. And I'm going to give you the number, 443-621-1907. 443-621-1907. We're going to go to Washington by the thousand. Al Sharpton, Martin Luther King III, and many, many others. Let's do that. Sign up on the bus trip and make your way.
His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet.
Talk in the day. Soul at night on the new 1010 WOLB.